Alright. Today we're gonna go straight for some no force. Some important no force verses in Ezekiel. And a lot of these types, like Pharaoh and the Assyrian and Tyre, are actually have not been fulfilled yet. And even though there may be some historic references, things that actually have come to pass, a lot of it has not come to pass and is therefore of specific value to us as far as prophecy is concerned, and are important in the overall understanding of the world as we know it, this earth, a flat earth, and the no force idea of the flat earth as being just a relic of what it once was. I'm going to try to move through this quickly and then go back and break down the words for you. So I'll start with just a general reading of the book of Ezekiel, chapter 31, and keeping it in context, starting at the beginning. And it came to pass, verse 1, it came to pass in the 11th year, in the 3rd month, in the 1st day of the month, that the word of Yahweh came to me, saying, verse 2, Son of man, speak unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and to his multitude, whom art thou like in thy greatness? So right off the bat, we realize that this is more than just Pharaoh, because he's questioning, who are you? Verse 3, Behold the Assyrian, even Ginsburg thinks it should read T. Eshur, a box tree, instead of Eshur. Eshur would be the Assyrian, but there is no thee, there is no article. So, the Assyrian is a type of Satan himself, and you will understand very deeply what we're getting into as far as this no trees thing and the ancient tree forest. I'll withhold my ideas till the end. Behold, the Assyrian was a cedar in Lebanon, with fair branches, and with a shadowing shroud, and of an high stature, and his top was among the thick boughs. Verse 4, The waters made him great, the deep set him up on high, and her rivers running round about his plants, and set out her little rivers into all the trees of the field. Verse 5, Therefore his height was exalted above all the trees of the field. What part of all? All. Means he was the tallest tree in all the field, which is more than just a field, as you'll understand. And his boughs were multiplied, and his branches became long because of the multitude of waters when he shot forth. Verse 6, All the fowls of heaven made their nests in his boughs, and under his branches did all the beasts of the field bring forth their young, and under his shadow dwelt all great nations. What part of all did you not get there? So basically, all the fowls, all the branches, all the fields, all the young, all of the nations, all the beasts. Verse 7. Thus was he fair in his greatness, and the length of his branches, for his root was by great waters. Verse 8. The cedars in the garden of Yahweh could not hide him. He was greater than the cedars in the garden of Yahweh. So we're clearly speaking of the Garden of Eden here. The Garden of Yahweh. The fir trees were not like his boughs. The chestnut trees were not like his branches. Nor any tree in the Garden of Yahweh, there it is again, was like unto him in his beauty. This is a reference to Genesis. His great beauty and intelligence. Verse 9. I have made him fair by the multitude of his branches, so that all the trees of Eden, there it becomes incredibly clear what we're speaking of, all the trees of Eden that were in the garden of Yahweh envied him. Verse 10, therefore thus saith Yahweh Elohim, because thou hast lifted up thyself in height, and he hath shot up his top among the thick boughs, and his heart is lifted up in his height. Verse 11, I have therefore delivered him into the hand of the mighty one of the heathen. He shall surely deal with him. I have driven him out for his wickedness, his self-exaltation, his wickedness. Verse 12, and strangers and the terrible of the nations have cut him off and have left him upon the mountains and in all the valleys. His branches are fallen and his boughs are broken by all the rivers of the land, and all the people of the earth are gone down from his shadow, all the people, and have left him. Verse 13, upon his ruin shall all the fowls of the heaven remain, and all the beasts of the field shall be upon his branches. Verse 14, to the end that none of all the trees by the waters exalt themselves for their height, neither shoot up the top among the thick boughs, neither the trees stand up in their height, all that drink water, for they are all delivered unto death. All these great trees, as a result, died as a result of this situation. So we're speaking of a great, great biblical plot here that reaches throughout time. The fall of Satan. All the great trees are destroyed. And to the end, 14, to the end that none of the trees by the waters exalt themselves for their height, neither shoot up their top among the thick boughs, neither their trees stand up. Okay. Continuing in Ezekiel 31, verse 14. Neither their trees stand up in their height, all that drink water, for they are all delivered unto death, to the nether parts of the earth. This will become a continuing theme, the nether parts of the earth. We'll get into this. The nether parts of the earth. In the midst of the children of men, with them that go down to the pit. Verse 15, thus saith Yahweh Elohim, in the day when he went down to the grave, I caused a mourning. I covered the deep for him, and I restrained the floods thereof, and the great waters were stayed. And I caused Lebanon to mourn for him, and all the trees of the field fainted for him. They fainted, they fell. Verse 16, I made the nations to shake at the sound of his fall, and I cast him down to hell with them that descend into the pit, and all the trees of Eden, the choice and the best of Lebanon, all that drink water, shall be comforted in the nether parts of the earth. Verse 17, they also went down into hell with him. So the nether parts of the earth, obviously hell. They also went down into hell with him, unto them that be slain of the sword. What is the sword? This is the sword in Eden. There's only one sword in Eden. And that was the sword that cut in all directions, that was held by the angel to keep the way of Eden, to hide it from Adam and Eve, that they eat not of the tree of life and live forever in the fallen state. So this sword that cut all, this magnificent sword, was the sword of Yahweh, the sword of the Spirit, the sword of truth, that cuts in all directions and is endless in power and ability. That's why we have these giant stumps all over the earth. What could cut something like that? Only the sword of Yahweh. And many answers in this chapter. We'll break them down. Okay. And I made all the nations to shake at the sound of his fall. It's thundering right now. Shake at the sound of his fall when I cast him down to hell with them that descend into the pit, and all the trees of Eden, the choice and the best of Lebanon, all that drink water, shall be comforted in the nether parts of the earth. They also went down into hell with him, unto them that be slain with the sword, and they that were his arm, that dwelt on his, under his shadow in the midst of the heathen. Verse 18, to complete. To whom art thou thus in glory and in greatness among the trees of Eden? Starting to get the real story of Eden, the tree of good and evil. It's a lot more real than the way we have turned it into a metaphor of late. Yet shalt thou be brought down with the trees of Eden into the nether parts of the earth, hell. Thou shalt lie in the midst of the uncircumcised with them that be slain by the sword, the great sword of Yahweh. This is Pharaoh and all his multitude, saith Yahweh Elohim. Obviously, we're not talking about a certain Pharaoh. We're talking about the word Pharaoh, which we have yet to translate. As we can see here, I'll just talk until my time runs out. We are dealing with the type and the pattern of the actual situation that was really happening in Eden. The real situation. It's strange, but as I get older, I'm finding out that a lot of things that I thought were metaphors are actually quite real. And when the Bible says something, a lot of times it really means it. And unless it's somehow aligned in some way that you can tell it's a metaphor, generally you can assume that it means what it says. And we're finding out that with flat earth and with the no trees movement and understanding that Yahweh knew what he was doing, and science so-called as and men have covered it up, and the reason being they don't want us to know what Yahweh really is and the truth of the Bible and how great the purposes are of Yahweh for his people and how significant we are in his creation, how incredibly great and magnificent we are as his children, as his inheritors of his creation, and how grand the great purpose is when it all comes down to it. Okay, I'll go ahead and wrap this up because I'm going to cut off in a minute. Bless you in Yahweh's name and Yeshua Messiah, and prayers to you. Protection for standing in the truth. I know I've been attacked. Here I am in my little tiny house I built, and I've had non-stop problems. My roof is falling apart. I'm not getting roofed before winter. Got plastic on my roof and cats attacked it. I've fallen off my roof and broke my rib. I've had non-stop problems. My husband left me, sent me off, put me on a plane, sent me off with no money for 3 months. I've been literally eating leaves, and it has been one hard go. I'm thankful for the land I do have, bought and paid for, and that Yahweh is taking care of me, and I'm expecting great blessings and miracles, and they are happening. I am suffering, but he didn't say you wouldn't be suffering. He just said, I'll be with you. And he has been. I'm very thankful to be found worthy to suffer in the name of Yeshua alongside of him, to carry that cross, to bear that cross. Love you all. Take care. I'll show you some pictures of trees as we go out. I painted, ironically, not even knowing this is a tree painting I did with scripture in it about what Yeshua, who was crucified on a tree, we'll get into all this, the trees of the Bible. You can see the actual scriptures written within the tree cross.